2008 to 2013. And in 2013, he served as the chair of the committee. In the early 80s, Dr. Brink was one of the pioneers of string theory and superstring theory. This theory, basically, to make a long story short, is concerned with how matters interact. In other words, how we are made of. One of the deepest pursuits of human being, trying to understand it. He has been associated with many, other than being one of the most prominent physicists in Sweden, he has many associations with other academic institutes around the world, including the EU, UK, France, Germany, Russia, and places in South America. Recently, he's also been a visiting professor at Singapore Nanyang University. So we are very happy to have him to give a talk today. So let us welcome Professor Lars Brink.
So thank you. So thank you for this reception. It's very nice to be here in this very interesting, very beautiful country. And I can assure you that we have a very good time here. People were telling us coming here in Singapore, they say, you should go to Taiwan because people are so nice there. And I will go back to Singapore and tell them that that's right. People are very nice in Taiwan. So, you know, I'm coming from a very small country, very far away, very much up north, where, so north of where I live, I think there were just, 0.1-0.2% of the world's population live there. So it's rather exotic from this point of view, from your country. But there's one week of the year when Sweden is in the limelight, when the newspapers report from Sweden, when there are lots of reporters hanging around in Sweden, and that's the first week of October. That's when the Nobel Prizes are announced. And what I'm going to do today is that I will tell you more or less in equal shares about the person Alfred Nobel. Who was this man who, you know, started these prizes? And then I will tell you about the prizes, how they are chosen, and what's the criteria, and a little bit more about that. So,
Guys,我是从一个很远很远的地方，在很北这个不是寻常的地方来的。 那个地方呢是占了世界人口很小的一部分，不是一个很重要的国家，但是呢，每年有一个礼拜，它是世界媒体的焦点。这个礼拜呢就十月中的一个礼拜，在那个礼拜呢，因为有这个诺贝尔奖的颁礼，所以我今天就要报告关于那个事情。Okay.
So let me start by describing the life of Alfred Nobel. He was born in Stockholm in 1833, and he died in 1896 in San Remo in Italy. He was, as we heard from your president, a chemist, engineer, innovator, armament manufacturer, and the inventor of dynamite. And in physics, he has been honored by one of the elements 102 called Nobelium. He was born in Stockholm, in that street. The house is still there. You can see the plaque on it. And this is a picture of his parents. Well, actually, it's his mother. That's from a drawing. but it's really a picture of his father. So his father was what is very popular these days, you would call, he was an entrepreneur. He was starting companies and he was getting broke, and starting new companies and getting broke. And he, in 1838, he got broke. And he had no income, he didn't know what to do to start with. So he left the family in Stockholm and he went to St. Petersburg in Russia. And there he founded another company called Fonderie Atelier Mécanique Nobel. And that was very successful. So after a few years, the family could come over. So from 1842 to 1859, the family lived in Russia, in St. Petersburg. And that's a picture of where they lived, in Petrogradskaya embankment. And they lived a very, you know, comfortable life there. They were very successful. And Alfred and his brothers, you know, had private tutors. So they, we heard, he became fluent in Swedish, French, Russian, English, and German. He learned Italian later on. And he was, as we also heard, very interested in literature. But he studied also chemistry. His father wanted him to be an engineer. And then, you know, in 1850, at the age of only 17, his father sent him out first to Paris, then to the United States, really to study chemistry. And, you know, just think about that. At that time, there were no airplanes. He had to go by boat, by train, whatever it was. So he was out for a long time on his own, 17 years old. But it was a very successful trip, and he was very receptive. So he learned about a new subject called nitroglycerin. It had been invented in Italy in 1847. So he took this knowledge with him back to Russia. This was the time of the Crimean War. And so his father was, the beginning, successful, because he was selling weapons to the Russian army, especially some kind of shells. But after the war, the Russian army was not interested in the products from Nobel. And again, he went broke. So the family left and went back to Sweden. But they left two brothers. And these two brothers eventually would start the Russian oil industry. They became extremely rich, but the family lost everything in 1917 when the was the Russian Revolution. So anyhow, okay.
So 就像所有创业的人呢，他是常常是成功失败，成功失败。在1938年的时候呢，他又破产了，所以他从瑞典呢到俄国的圣彼得堡，在那里，在1942年到1959年，他有做一个化学的工厂，非常非常成功，所以他家是住的那个地方。那但是后来这个你们1842年对，那但是那后来这个在 Crimea War 之后，他本来是卖这个武器也很成功，但是呢在那个战争之后呢，他的武器没有人要了，所以他又破产了，那他又回到瑞典，那除了两个兄弟之外。这两个兄弟留在俄国，就是开始了俄国的石油工业，非常非常成功。但是在1917年，在俄国革命的时候呢，他们所有的资产又没有了。
So when they went back, they started to manufacture nitroglycerin. However, in 1864, you can see what happened. The whole factory exploded. And that was a big tragedy. Five people died, among them his younger brother. So it was clear that they had to do something. You could not use nitroglycerin as such. In Europe and United States, or you know, there was a big demand for explosives because they were building railroads, they were building tunnels, and they really needed it. So Alfred Nobel, he was experimenting, and then he found, you know, that if he incorporated it in a subject called diatomaceous earth, it became much more safe, and you could handle it very easily. You could take a dynamite and you can bend it, you can throw it, and did not explode. It was only exploding when it was really ignited. So that was his big invention, and he got a patent in 1867. And from that point on, he started to tour the world to set up factories, to build and to manufacture dynamite. And he settled in Paris, this is a picture from his apartment in Paris on the Rue Malakoff. It doesn't exist any longer, but you could see that he lived a rich life there, but he was working all the time. And over the years he founded factories and laboratories in some 90 different places around the world, in more than 20 countries. And although he lived in Paris much of his life, he was constantly traveling. And Victor Hugo, the French writer, at one time described him as Europe's richest vagabond. When he was not traveling or engaging in business activities, he worked intensely in his various laboratories, trying to improve, you know, explosives, but also he had all sorts of other ideas. And so he had been working very hard for quite some time, and at the age of 43, he was feeling like an old man, he said. So he said he needed a secretary and a supervisor of the household. He wanted to be more stable in Paris, perhaps, and he needed someone to look after the household. So he advertised, and he got an Austrian woman to come as a secretary, Bertha. She was from a very high nobility in Austria. Her father was a field marshal, but he had been impoverished by the wars at the time. This was not a good time for Austria. They lost several wars. So she had worked as a tutor in the von Suttner family. And she had fallen in love with the son in the family whom she was a tutor for. He was 7 years younger. So that was not proper, they thought, or the family thought. So she had to leave, and she came to Paris to be the secretary. She and Alfred had started to discuss a lot. She was very interested in the peace movement. But after a week, she left. She went back. She eloped with the lover. They went, you know, abroad, and they got married. And they were then working in the peace movement for the rest of their lives. And she was very much engaged in peace conferences. That was what people were interested in, to organize meetings to discuss peace. But she was all the time writing letters, having correspondence with Alfred Nobel, and she was telling him about, you know, all these peace movements. She also wrote a very famous book, Down with the Weapons. The idea was at the time that one should abolish all weapons. If you could just abolish all weapons, the world would be much more happy. I think it's still true, by the way. Eventually, she was sort of the source behind the Peace Prize, you can imagine. And she was also one of the first recipients of the Nobel Peace Prize. But after she had left, Alfred met another very young Austrian woman, very much the opposite, not educated. She'd been working in a flower shop. And somehow, she was, you know, a companion of him. He was, for quite some time, it was a rather difficult sort of situation for him. And it, you know, after some 15 years or so, eventually they split up, and that was not a good relation for him. But we're now in the late 1880s. Then, you might not know, but Italy was a new founded state at the time. And Italy had consisted of many small, you know, countries. They were united in 1860, but it was they had, you know, quarrels with the French about where to put the border along the Mediterranean coast. And Alfred Nobel, he was selling weapons to the Italians, and the French government didn't like that. So somehow he was more or less forced to leave Paris, and he went to San Remo, which on the north coast of Italy, very close to France. It's a beautiful place with a climate which is probably rather similar to here. There he set up a laboratory. And this house is still there. If you ever come to San Remo, you should visit the house. It's a museum. And at that time, he was trying to invent new explosives for ammunition. So he was having a big cannon in the garden. This was next to the sea. And he was shooting out in the sea. And the fishermen were a bit unhappy about that. So they complained. You know, those things, I don't think you can do it today. I think there would be stronger regulations now. But that's what he did. And the cannon is still there in the garden. So if you ever come there, that's another interesting thing to see. So this is, you know, around 1890. He was now 57 years old. And he had not lived in Sweden since the 1860s, where he lived in Sweden for a few years. He had been visiting Sweden once a year because his mother lived for quite long, but she was now there. So he thought he must have some connections with Sweden. So he bought a mansion in the western part of Sweden, and with that came a small factory making guns again. That eventually became one of the biggest weapon industries in the world, and during the World War II, for example, it was selling guns to both sides. Sweden was neutral. Again, he had a laboratory there, but this will be important for the future, so that's why I mentioned it. You know, he was a bit, he was reflecting about his life at the time, and he was, of course, a bit worried that he had been spending his life building explosive, ammunition, and stuff like that. So he wrote one of his, he wanted to say that, to really explain, you know, why he did what he was doing. So he said, "My dynamite will sooner lead to peace than 1,000 world conventions. As soon as men will find that in one instant whole armies can be utterly destroyed, they surely will abide by golden peace." we now know that that's not true. It's still not being very much of a peace man. We also heard that he had some ambitions in literature, and he wrote a play, and he wanted to get it published. Nobody wanted to publish it. Eventually it was published in 2003 by the Nobel Foundation. It's not a great play. He was not a good writer. It might even be one of the worst plays published. So even though he had those interests, this was not his cup of tea. So Alfred Nobel, he was an inventor. He was awarded 350 patents, which is a huge number at that time. But his best invention was the Nobel Prize. He was writing his will. He started to write a will in the beginning of the 1890s, and one can follow his ideas from one to the other. And this is the last one. It's a rather short one. It's a very unconventional one, and I will translate part of it. And this is what we should be discussing from now on. He said, "The whole of my remaining realizable estate should be dealt with in the following way: the capital invested in safe securities by my executors shall constitute a fund, the interest on which should be annually distributed in the form of prizes to those who during the preceding year should have conferred the greatest benefit on mankind." And then he said that should be 5 prizes. The first one is physics. There you should be the one who had made the most important discovery or invention within the field of physics. In chemistry, it's discovery or improvement. In physiology or medicine, it's discovery. And in literature, he said, the one who's made the most outstanding work in an ideal direction. You might wonder what an ideal direction is. And, you know, people have wondered about that, and people have discussed it, and we can discuss that later. And then came, you know, Bertha von Suttner's part, so to speak. One part to the person who shall have made the most of or the best work for fraternity between nations, for the abolition or reduction of standing armies, and for holding and promoting of peace conferences. So that's, I think it's rather clear. It just might be very difficult to find these people. And then there was a bit of a dynamite also in the last sentence, because it said, "No consideration whatever shall be given to the nationality of the candidates, but that the most worthy shall receive the prize, whether he be Scandinavian or not." That was, I would say, would be discussed a lot.
二十之前写的，他写了很多遗嘱，这是他最后一个遗嘱，这是最重要的，就是设立这个，基本上就是设立这诺贝尔奖。他说要把他的资产呢都变成股票，然后呢每年他赚的钱呢就拿来给在五个领域里，物理、化学。医学，文学跟这个和平。那他说一个很重要的事情呢，是考虑这个得奖的人呢是完全不能考虑他的国籍。他说那个人可以是瑞典人，但是也完全不需要是瑞典人。
So then, on December 10th. 1896, Alfred Nobel dies in San Remo, in his villa there, alone with his servants. And he had, in 1890, he had hired a new assistant, Ragnar Sulman. He was only 20 years old at the time. And in the will, he was named as one of two executors. So he was the one to take care of, you know, and see to that the will was implemented. He came to San Remo. He got the message. He came first to San Remo, and then he saw the will, and he was the first to really understand the importance of it. And he was then had to collect all the fortune. So he had to you know, because the fortune was, you know, he had securities in all sorts of banks around the world. But most of it was in Paris. So he went to Paris sort of secretly. He went around from one bank to another to collect them. He had two guns in his pockets. And nobody somehow realized what he was doing. He managed to get them out from France to Sweden, similarly from Scotland and Germany. And once, you know, he got all the papers up to Sweden. Then eventually the French government realized. The French government wanted to tax the you know, they wanted to get money from this. So they were starting to argue that he should be regarded as French. And there was a lot of illegal discussions about these things. So he managed to, as I said, to collect everything before the authorities in the foreign countries knew of Nobel's disease. And then came a long series of lawsuits and discussions and legal ordeals. Eventually it was established that Nobel was Swedish. And that's because he had bought this mansion in Sweden, and he had spent, you know, the summers there during the 90s. Somehow he was regarded, he was Swedes. And that was good for tax reasons. But then, you know, the relatives were not very happy. They, of course, had, you know, in modern times you would say he was a billionaire. They would, of course, like to have a billion or so, you know, for themselves. They didn't essentially get anything. And the king, the Swedish king, he was furious because he couldn't accept that money could be given to foreigners. That was the last part of the will I showed you. So he was, this young assistant, Suman, he was called up to the king, and the king just gave him, you know, a very hard time, saying that this cannot be done. But the legal system worked, you know, and somehow it took some 3-4 years to establish the will. And the last, and also perhaps the most important thing, is that if you look at the will, there is no beneficiary of the will. It doesn't say that the money should go to them. It's only said that the money should be given as prizes. But that was solved by setting up a Nobel Foundation. So they essentially got the money. And from that sort of money, one could divide out the interest in five pieces and establish the prizes.
遗嘱写了没多久之后，他就去世了。那时候他有一个很年轻，才20多岁的助理 Solman。这个人呢，他看到他其实不是在意大利，他在别的国家，他就跑去。他看到这个遗嘱之后呢，他就知道这个遗嘱是非常非常重要。一个很重要的一点呢，是这个遗嘱没有受益人。啊，但是呢，第一，他要先把这个钱都收集好，所以他很秘密的跑到法国、德国其他国家呢。把钱都想办法在国家知道他在干什么之前呢，都想办法移到瑞典。那后来这些国家就非常非常生气，尤其是法国，因为他大部分资产在法国，都要抽税。但经过3-4年的法律的挣扎之后呢，大家决定他 的确这个钱呢是应该在瑞士瑞典，然后瑞典可以抽他的税。还另外一件事情是因为他的这个啊，他的当然他的家族也都希望分到钱，但是他们完全没有分到钱。瑞典的国王也非常生气，因为这个钱呢是可以给外国人的，所以他也很生气，他就把这个 Solomon 拿去痛骂了一顿。但是结果他还是这个年轻人成功的设计了一个诺贝尔基金，就这个钱呢就是经过这基金可以给他们选到的人。
OK so there were five prizes and the prize awarding institutions was decided in the will. So it was for physics and chemistry it should be the Royal Academy of Sciences. For medicine it should be the Karolinska Institute, which is a huge institute in Sweden for medicine. For literature it was the Swedish Academy of Letters. And for peace he wanted to give also something to the Norwegians. So it was the Norwegian Parliament was decided to give it that they should give the prize. Norway at the time was in a union with Sweden, but they had their own parliament, so they were very happy. They accepted it immediately, but the Academy of Sciences, they were very hesitant that we cannot do it, they say it's too difficult, and eventually they were more or less bribed by the foundation, saying you will get a good sum of money, so that you can really work on it. And this is so by having that, they could establish Nobel committees. They could, pay the committee. They can give the Nobel committee means, to do the job. So then, it was all set up, and the first prize came in 1901. And the physics committee did a good job. The first winner was Wilhelm Conrad Röntgen, the discoverer of the X-rays. And he had discovered the X-rays in 1894. And it was really clearly that this was a fantastic discovery. It was useful in medicine, it was useful in experiments in physics, so much was using it. This is a picture from the first ceremony. There were 180 people at the ceremony. The king didn't come because, as you heard, he didn't like the idea. But they held it anyhow. There were 180 people, no women. That reflects the time. So let me now go through the prizes a bit more. So physics is the first prize. It said one part of the person who shall have made the most important discovery or invention within the field of physics. Most important discovery. It has to be interpreted. Well, the way we interpret it and has been interpreted by the Nobel Committee and the Nobel Foundation from the beginning is that it should not be a lifetime achievement. It's not the second discoverer who did it much better. It's not the one who did the most beautiful experiment. And it's not a theoretical discovery that has not been experimentally verified. So it's well defined in a sense. One just have to follow these rules. It means it's not always the best physicist who gets the prize. There is an element of luck. You might discover something by accident. Okay, that's good enough. So we usually say that you don't need to be an Einstein to get the prize, but it helps if you are. So give me some examples of people who did not get the prize. Arnold Sommerfeld was the pioneer in the early quantum physics. He was an advisor to a number of laureates. He was a leader for a whole generation of German physicists. He was the most respected physicist in Germany probably during the first 30 years of last century. But it didn't do this, you know, great discovery. So in the end, he didn't get it. I mean, he was discussed, you know, many times because he did many, many nice piece of work, but he didn't get it. A later example is John Wheeler in the United States, who was a pioneer, it's wrongly spelled, I see, in nuclear particle physics, gravitation. He was an advisor to many American physicists, to Richard Feynman, for example. Both these were leaders, but they did not become laureates. If you look at, you're not giving it for collected work. If you look at the Albert Einstein, who got the prize for 1921, he got it, it says, for his services to theoretical physics, and especially for his discovery of the law of the photoelectric effect. That's, I mean, he did. Einstein did so many things, but this is one of the things, it, great discoveries, and it's absolutely of Nobel quality, so no problem with that, in a sense. We can, I can expect questions later on. Hans Bethe is another one who did so many things, but he got it for his contribution to the theory of nuclear reactions, especially his discoveries concerning the energy production in stars. That's a piece of work he did, you know, probably took him a few weeks to do it. He realized just how the sun is working. It was a great discovery, but he did many other things. But he did get it for one discovery. It's not for the most beautiful experiment. And let me describe one very beautiful experiment by Pound and Rebke from it was done in 1959. So what they did was that they were measuring how fast time is going at the bottom floor of the physics building and the sixth floor of the physics building at Harvard. Is there any difference between the time at the sixth floor and the first floor, you might ask? You don't really recognize if you go to the sixth floor that time is going faster. But it does. But it's a very small effect. And this is something that Einstein also had discovered. It's an effect with 10 to the minus 15. It's a fantastically beautiful experiment. And they use all so interesting. But it only confirmed what's called the equivalence principle. And nobody mistrusted that. So they didn't really discover any new thing. They used what's called the Mössbauer effect. And Mössbauer, he got the Nobel Prize because he had discovered... Let me go to the other alternative. Not a theoretical discovery that has not been experimentally verified. This is the most famous paper of Stephen Hawking from 1975. It's called Particle Creations by Black Holes. Stephen Hawking showed that in a quantum mechanical world, a black hole is supposed to be an object that does not radiate anything. You cannot see a black hole because it's black. However, quantum mechanically, they are not completely black. This is a fantastic discovery. It's obviously correct, but it's not been experimentally verified. Stephen Hawking is not very happy that he's not got the Nobel Prize, but you know, rules are rules. It's very difficult to advocate that one could give it for that.
他举了一些例子，是怎么样才可以得到这个诺贝尔物理奖？怎么样是没有？他说，并不是说要最聪明的物理学家，也不是最漂亮的这个实验，是在那一年做了一个发现，而且呢，是第一个发现。你第二次的话就不算数。那这个大家，我为什么讲这个？因为大家比较了解黑洞，黑洞就是。引力的一个洞，它基本上把所有东西都吸进去。但是呢，这个霍金呢，他就认识到黑洞其实可以发光。OK， 那这是一个非常非常好的发现，大家相信它是正确的。但是到现在为止， 还没有一个实验来证明它，所以它到现在还是拿不到奖。
Okay. You know, a discovery should have what we call scientific height. It should be like a watershed. There should be a before and an after. And one of the most typical examples is the prize to Chen Yingyang and Song Daoli in 1957 for the penetrating investigation of the so-called parity laws, which has led to important discoveries regarding the elementary particles. What they discovered was that the world is not symmetric on the left and right at the most fundamental level. There was a bombshell at the time, and they proposed this in the summer of 1956. The experiments were done and published mid-January, and the final date for nomination was the end of January. So that was very quick, and it was such a, you know, great discovery. This is a typical, that's what Nobel committees really would like. Let me give you another example. It's one would really like to point to one paper, to my countryman Hannes Alvén in 1970. It says, for fundamental work and discoveries in magnetohydrodynamics with fruitful applications in different parts of plasma physics. I will show you his paper. This is the abstract of the paper. This is the paper, half a page in Nature. And it's even more interesting if you're a physicist and you look at the equations, you will recognize all the equations. It starts with Maxwell's equation. It's coupling it to the hydrodynamic equation. And just do some manipulations, and he ends up with plasma waves. And he's saying that he gets waves with the velocity of the waves amount to 60 centimeters per second. And he says that this is the velocity with which the sunspot zone moves to this equator during the sunspot cycle. So he, by just combining them, he found, you know, how the plasma waves in the sun is working and in other plasmas. This is... You know, he also says the matter is further discussed in a paper which will appear. I don't think it appeared. It didn't need to appear. Everything is there. So this is also a good case, you know, of a discovery.
Let me just Alvén 的得奖文章。刚才你看的那一页就是文章的全部。它有一个。有个摘要，然后有半页的文章。这篇文章发现这个电浆的波，所以呢就够了，因为它是一个很重要的发现，虽然文章非常非常短。
So let me then show a little bit about the prize in 2013, which was a famous prize to François Englert and Peter Higgs for the theoretical discovery of a mechanism that contributes to our understanding of the origin of the mass of subatomic particles, and which recently was confirmed through the discovery of the predicted fundamental particle by the ATLAS and CMS experiments at CERN's Large Hadron Collider. So what is these two people did? Well, Englert, together with his collaborator Robert Braut, who unfortunately died 2 years before this, they were computing essentially what's called two Feynman diagrams. For someone in, you know, have learned about Feynman diagrams, this is essentially trivial. But they interpreted it correctly. Peter Higgs, he was just doing some simple, he was coupling electromagnetism to scalar field, it's called, and he was defining a new vector field. New what's called field strength, and he got this equation, which is the equation for a massive vector particles with what's called gauge invariance. This is also showing that what they were after, that one can give mass to particle, in this case a vector particle. So this is also this is a very, very short paper, and this is also this is short, but it's giving several examples. So it takes three pages in a journal. So this is, you see, these are discoveries, and you know, they you can pinpoint that this is eventually, these are theoretical discoveries that were experimentally confirmed.
I'll mention this. Okay. 这是2013年得奖的一个文章，这个文章也是很短，只有三页，而且它计算也非常非常简单，它是一个非常非常非常简单的物理现象。但是这两个人呢，其实有第三个人，但是得奖之前两年他去世了，他们给了一个正确的诠释，而且呢，他们预测会有另外一个例子，所以虽然简单，但是正确，所以他们得奖。啊，对不起，就是这个奖呢，就是我们演讲的Dr. Brink 在做物理诺贝尔物理委员会的时候，在做主席的时候挑出来的这个奖。
Okay, so then, what is the procedure for you know, really selecting these people? Well, as I said, there has to be there is a Nobel Committee within the Academy of Sciences who is doing the job, with 5 regular members. One of them is the chairperson. There could be adjoint members, and there is a secretary. So these are the people elected for, you know, three year periods that are, you know, doing all the groundwork. And in the, for example, in the committee in 2013, you see that this is essentially mostly Swedish names. Actually, it's a French name, but this woman, she's working in Sweden. So the working language is Swedish. Well, that's good, you know, because it's very few people speak Swedish. So we can be rather secretive, even when we speak to each other. So this is... So the procedure started in September the year before, when the Nobel Committee is trying to you know, cover the whole world, asking for nominations. So we were the ones who can. So invitations are sent to Academy members of the previous Nobel laureates, is of course a good source. Nordic professors are included. They're all the professors in the Scandinavian, in the Nordic country. But then the physics professors at selected university. So that, we have a list. We are trying to cover every university in the world, more or less. I hope that also this university is covered. And then, you know, every year we select certain number of those universities. We write to the deans of the physics department and ask for a list of all the physics professors. And then we send out. We send out of the order of 3,000 letters. We get back usually 450 nominations. It's a bit surprising that it's not more, but we don't understand why, but that's the way it goes. So we get, you know, say 400 nominations every year. And then so, how do we go through? We have to read all these nominations. We have to work through them. And then we have to evaluate the various nominations. Either do we do that by the committee members have to work through, but we also ask external experts. Every year we ask of the order of 20 external experts to look at priceworthiness, and also to say who did what. But we can ask, who was the first to do this, in your opinion? Who is it? And then you would say, is it of scientific height enough? And that takes more or less the spring. By the end of May, usually we get all these reports. And then the real work for the committee starts, because the committee has to review all fields of physics every year. So the committee works of the summit to write a comprehensive review of all the fields. Of course, we can steal a little bit from previous years. Now with modern techniques, it's easier than in the old days. Well, I guess they had to glue things together in the old days. But essentially, the summer is spent writing a report on all the fields. And the committee is finished by the end of August. So the committee then has a proposal that's sent to the Academy of Sciences. And then it's... what do I say? Then all the physicists in the academy discuss it during the month of September. We meet twice, have long discussions. All the physicists, order of 30 or 40 people, take part in those meetings. And one has to the committee has to work hard to convince that this is a good proposal they have. Mostly they succeed, but the other physicists might have opinions. They might propose something different. And the final selection is really done on the first Tuesday of October, when the whole academy votes. So it's not decided until then. You cannot be sure if we've been working for the whole year on a certain proposal that it's accepted. And the whole academy consists of people from all categories, you know, not the only physicists, chemists, economists, you know, and all sorts of other people.
Explain this. 他这个每年二月初二月一号就把邀请别人提名，大概送出去3000个邀请，这是送出去的地方是包括所有北欧的这个主要的大学的物理系，然后呢还有其他各个国家的物理系，然后呢他大概收400到450个提名，这个提名之后呢在这个委员会就要仔细看每一个案子都要仔细看，而且还有这个送外审主要是厘清到底谁做了什么事情，他是不是第一个人做的，然后他们就会有最后一个结果呢，会他们有一个建议送给这个瑞典皇家学院，皇家学院就会考虑他们的提案，但是呢皇家学院可能也不一定接受他们提案，皇家学院可能自己有他们的提名，然后在这个快要到10月的时候呢，这个整个皇家学院全体委员会投票这之前是完全不知道谁会得到，因为是他们这个委员会提出来，不一定会投票会当选会选上，那之后呢就开记者会。
So what are the regulations? Well, there should be at most 3 laureates. It could be a divided prize, it could be 2 different, it happens. It could be a joint prize, it could be say 2 or 3 people for the same, but it could be also be 2 people, one for one subject and one for another. The full prize these days are 8 million Swedish crowns, around $1 million, and the deliberations are secret for 50 years. And in physics and chemistry, no prize has been given to organizations or large collaborations. However, this can be decided by the academy itself. You know, in the Peace Prize, it can be given to organizations. And that was decided already way back in 1906 by the Norwegian Parliament. But it's not, in physics and chemistry, it's not been decided whether one should do it or not. In medicine, it's been decided that it can only be given to persons. And as of 2013, when I wrote this, you know, there were 47 prizes given to one laureate. In the beginning, it was usually just one laureate. In more recent times, it's been usually 2 or 3. So these numbers are catching up with that. So let me iterate. In 2013, there were 2 meetings, you know, among in the academy, September 11th, September 25th. And what happens after that? Total silence. So then all the physicists in the academy They know what the proposal is, and then everyone has to just keep our mouths shut. So then, at that time, on October, there was this presentation of the proposal to the academy, and then it was the voting. And after the voting, the committee goes to a special room, have a telephone there, and calls the laureates. You know, there are all lots of stories about fake telephone calls. And so they said, this is a very important telephone call to you from Stockholm, Sweden. Please do not hang up. In 1999, when Tuft and Veltman, two Dutch physicists, got it, Veltman was at that time retired. He had been for some 10 years or 15 years or so in the United States, moved back to Utrecht, and we had not been able to find his telephone number. He had a secret telephone number. So the permanent secretary of the academy calls to the secretary of the physics department in Utrecht. She said, no, we have been instructed not to give it to anybody. And the secretary said, well, he said, I can assure you that Professor Veltman will be very happy if you give us this number. Eventually she did, and we could reach him. So after, from October to December, comes the ceremony. And the ceremony starts while it's on the 10th of December. And this is from 2008, and you will recognize my colleague Pierre here. This is the way we're dressed in tails. This is as before. There is a ceremony where you have the king and the queen sitting. It's not a good picture. The laureates are sitting over there. I should probably use this. Here, the committee is sitting here, and there is one person each presenting the prize. And this is what me in 2008. I give a speech, 5 minutes. And then since there were three Japanese laureates, this is what I said at the end of it. I had practiced, you know, for a month trying to say this in Japanese. And I am, well, up to the day before or so, my wife was not very happy with how it sounded, even though in the end, I think it worked out well. People asked me, I didn't know that you knew Japanese. Well, I said, I don't. But what I said, you know, this is what I said. There was only one problem with my talk, and that was what comes next. So when the speech is over, everyone is supposed to raise. The king stands up and should deliver the prize to the laureate. The only problem was that it was only me and the two Japanese there who knew that I had finished. So I had to try to make signs, you know, that I couldn't do it to the king, but somehow it worked out.
It's funny, Darling Ming Ba, he is a委员，报告是谁的来讲？那是三个日本人，所以之前呢，他花了好几个月。准备一个日本的这个讲词，有一些就是讲词完了之后呢，他们都那他就要站起来要得奖，要这个接受奖，但是因为这个瑞典的国王他听不懂日文，所以不晓得那时候要站起来。
Professor Nambu couldn't come to the ceremony. His wife was not in such a good shape, so they had to stay in Chicago. So the ceremony was done in Chicago. this Swedish ambassador handing over the prize to him. But fortunately, Chicago is 7 hours behind Sweden, so we have been able to transmit my speech and the speech before that, and they had even the translation, so that could be given. So it worked out in Chicago too. So after the ceremony is a banquet, it's a dinner for 1,300 people in the City Hall of Stockholm, and it's a rather fancy dinner, as you can imagine. Takes some 4 hours, and it ends up with a ball. Like they might play Fritz Kreisler. Well, probably not. There's an honorary table, you know, for the laureates or for ambassadors, and this is a picture from 2004. So here we see that this is next to the Swedish king is always the senior physics laureate, and this is the queen to be. She's sitting there, and this is my great friend David Gross. Rather happy, a bit tired perhaps. Well, I have a few pictures here. This is the picture of Englert when he came in 2013. All the laureates, they have an attaché from the foreign ministry, so she was helping them all the time. This is the wife of Englert. They came. Everyone gets a diploma, apart from the medal and the money. And this is the diploma for François Englert, because they had done something called spontaneous symmetry breaking. They were using a potential. I described that to the artist doing that, and this was her personal interpretation of what I said. It's not exactly what I said, but there is some kind of value in it anyhow. When Alfred Nobel, when he wrote his will, he really believed that, you know, there would be such an enormous interest of the capital that the laureates should be able to live on that money for the rest of their lives. They did not need to teach, to go to faculty meetings. They should not be, you know, they could be free on their own. But you see, this is what happened if you go look in the monetary value of the prize. Here, it had fallen, you know, by a factor 4 almost. So the price, the money here in the 60s and 70s was not a big sum of money. The reason was that it was said in the will that it should be placed in safe securities. And that was not the way, like state bonds, it's not the way to invest money in the 20th century. So eventually, here around, they were allowed to invest in a more modern way. And you see what happened with the value, it went up. Eventually, unfortunately, well, here, this in 2008 was 10 million. So you see, it's really, it's catching up with what the amount what it should have been, you know, compared to 1901. So this is a big prize now. It's not, you know, the biggest prize any longer. There are many other prizes, but I think I dare say it's the most prestigious prize still, and we really would like to be that. And so it's still, you know, even every year it's even more and more interest in it, and the interest is spreading more and more to this part of the world. You know, new countries coming in, and you know the world is open for you all here. You know that there's so much future in Southeast Asia and China and the whole part of this part of the world. So there will be, I'm sure there will be many prizes from this continent, this part of the world too. So let me end by going back to Alfred Einstein. He's certainly the most famous physicist, most famous scientist, and he did get the prize for 1921. Actually, when they all had their deliberations in 1921, they decided to postpone giving the prize. They could not decide. And if the committee at that time had known that one day their deliberation would be not confidential any longer, I think they would have given the prize earlier. Well, they would have worked harder. Because now you can see, if you go to the website, Nobelprize.org, you can see who nominated who, up to, 50 years back. And you look at 1918, 1919, you see that Einstein was dominating the list of nominations. But anyhow, Sweden was a bit backward. They had not got accustomed to the modern physics at the time, the physicists working. So they were very hesitant, and it took quite some time before they could decide to give the prize to Einstein. Einstein by himself, he had divorced his wife, and he had promised his wife that when he gets the Nobel Prize, she will get the money. So, he knew that he would get it, and for good reasons. But in 1922, he got a letter in the beginning of September from Arrhenius, Swedish Nobel laureate in chemistry and the grand person in physics and chemistry in Sweden. He said to Einstein, we hope that you will be around so you can visit Stockholm at the end of the year, which was a good way of saying that they already then had decided. They knew that Einstein was supposed to go on a trip to Japan in October. Einstein said, no, I will go to Japan. So he went to Japan. When the final decision was made in November, beginning of November, he was on a boat to Japan. So that's where he got the telegram. So he couldn't come to the ceremony in Stockholm in 1922. Then there was a problem. Who should receive his prize? Well, the German ambassador said that he should be representing Einstein, because he said Einstein was German. The Swiss said no. He said Einstein is Swiss because he has a Swiss citizenship. And in the end, there was Einstein somehow meddled, and he got nobody to accept him. So he was given the money eventually in Berlin. But his diploma is very special, and you cannot read it here, but I will expand and I will show you the text, which is a bit miscrediting for the Nobel Committee. It says that independent of the value which after a possible confirmation may be attributed to the theory of relativity and gravitation, give the prize for his contributions, which I wrote before. So why did they have to have this, song and dance about the theory of relativity? They had given this was in a sense good enough for a Nobel Prize. This was Einstein's greatest discovery, the theory of relativity and gravitation. But it shows that they were not really sure that this was correct in 1922. And then you should know that Einstein's theory of the general relativity was essentially confirmed by himself already in 1915 when he was computing how the Mercury, the planet moves, there's an irregularity which he could completely calculate. It was further proven in 1919 when it was shown, how light bends when it passes the sun. And that gives a very definite value, which was checked at the in 1919. So he should have, they could have been much braver and give it for the theory of gravitation. We would have been sleeping better afterwards. But anyhow, that's what happened. But anyhow, Einstein came to Sweden to give his Nobel lecture. He came in the summer of, 11th of July, 1923. And he came to my hometown, Gothenburg, where they had a physics conference at the time. There were lots of people there. The king is sitting there. There are some older physics professors, soundly asleep, as you can see. And there are some people missing, probably, which is also not to our credit. So Einstein spent the day in Gothenburg. He gave a talk. And what did he talk about in his Nobel lecture? General relativity, of course. He had all the rights to do that. He's probably one of the few who has talked about something completely different from what he was given the Nobel Prize for. But as we said, he deserved it so well. And he is the only one who has given the Nobel lecture in Gothenburg, my hometown. And we say, that's enough for us. We don't let anyone else do it. We just have Einstein. Thank you.
Okay. Brink. Yeah?
I know it's very hard to make a decision for among those great achievements. But I just think about 2014 for LED, the Nobel yes. Prize goes for LED. My question is why Nick Horniak did not share with Nobel Prize with Nakamura?
Well, since it's confidential in 50 years, I cannot answer that question. But what you can do is that you can go to the homepage and you can read the scientific background text. And there you should be able to see how the committee thought about it at the time.
I'm very curious who nominated the committee. Evaluation committee members for Nobel Prize.
It's Nobel Committee.
Yeah.
Well, it's chosen among the members of the Academy of Sciences, and the idea is that one should have sort of a broad spectrum of physics represented in the committee, because we have to cover essentially all fields. So that's an internal.
It mean that evaluators never had a chance to win the prize? Evaluators of the committee, the members
of the committee, yes,
never have a chance to win the prize.
Yes, it's true. There are Swedish laureates who have stepped down from the committee when they see that how the winds are blowing. But usually, in order to work in the committee, if there is a nomination of someone in the committee, that member has to say that we discard that nomination. Well, I mean, it's usually rotating in among the members, so every member should serve 1 or 2 years or so. This is because there's a lot of work being the chair. I mean, it's almost a full-time job, for 6 months or so. The chairman has to represent the committee in so many other instances and present the prize, et cetera. There are a few questions which I'm missing.
A few questions, yeah.
Which I usually get.
Yeah. I can't think of any. Yeah.
Okay, so you have the committee give proposal and the academy votes. So I noticed that there was never a case where there was no recipient of that year. So does that mean that generically the academy just approves what the committee proposes?
Usually it does, you know, in a sense, you could say. But there is one case which is open now in 1956, where the committee wanted to wait 1 year. They said they were not completely finished. So they did not propose to give a prize. And the physics class of the academy approved of that. And then it came to the meeting in October. And then one person from the engineering class suggested that the prize should be given to for the transistor. And that was voted through. So that Bardeen, Britten, and Shockley, they were sort of voted in by the whole academy. And in retrospect, it's one of the great prizes. The transistor was a big discovery and invention at the same time.
Related question. How often is the proposal by the committee rejected by the academy?
Well, I mean, I cannot speak about for the last 50 years. But I can say so much that it's seldom. There are rumors that there are cases in medicine where, in more recent time, where the assembly there voted for something different from what the committee. These are rumors moving around. So I cannot substantiate that, but. Usually, there is some truth behind the rumor in this case. The question I wanted I'm expecting is about the 1957 prize.
Wu Jianxiong, yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Can you tell us something about that?
No, I can tell you, you see, I said that, in 1957 to Li and Yang went very quickly. And you can also now see, and if you go back in which is official, that T.D. Lee, he nominated Madame Wu several times after that. And I was discussing with Xian Yang, a few years ago. He said, "Why didn't you give the prize to Madame Wu together with us?" He said, "Well," I said, "I was just a boy at the time, so I had nothing to do with it." But so I asked him, "What do you think? Should she have been on the ticket?" "Of course," he said. And if you go back and read their paper, you can see that she had, first of all, she had a huge influence on their paper, because it was clear that she had. She was, a colleague of T.D. Lee at Columbia. It's clear that she had told them that you should, one could check this in Cobalt 60. I mean, so she knew exactly what to do, and they are proposing that, but that's her idea because they thank her, and she was the first one to discover it really experimentally. I mean, so. I would say it's a mistake, and it's a grave mistake, and I think generations afterwards are we're sorry that it happened like that. Usually, Swedish physics has been rather practical. It goes back to the mining industry and all these things a few hundred years back. So physics professors were usually very practical professors in experimental physics, rather little theory. It's only in the 1950s when the committee was dominated by some very strong theorists. And these strong theorists at the time, they did not bring up Madame Wu's name. So I regret that.
1957年，李政道跟杨振宁，得了物理奖，他们的文章是1956年出来的，1957年就得到了，而且是1956年年底， 1957年年初呢，得到实验证明，做实验呢是吴健雄。大家一直都很奇怪，为什么吴健雄没有拿到奖？这个我们Dr. Brin 刚才解释了一下，因为他个人，后来大家都觉得其实他吴健雄应该得那个奖，因为在李根阳的文章里面呢，他们的实验呢其实是吴健雄提出来的，因为吴健雄知道他可以做那个实验。但是不晓得为什么，那时候就没有得奖，所以他觉得大家这个物理委员会觉得是一个错误，是一个遗憾。不过，吴健雄是1997年去世的。
I can also add, you know, that she did several discoveries. She was one thing which is very popular now is called entanglement, quantum entanglement. How, you know, quantum mechanically.Particles that came from the same source somehow know of each other. That's very much used in, you know, in quantum information and all these things. She was the first one to experimentally verify that in 1949. So that's another great discovery of hers. Often forgotten when people talk about the entanglement these days because they believe that it was discovered much later, but it's not true. She was the first.
吴健雄还做了一件很重要的事情，在1949年的时候，现在因为是讲这个量子打结嘛 ，OK， 纠结量子纠结是跟将来也许更好的传递信息的方法，还有牵涉到量子物理的基本的性质，现在是非常非常红的一个题目。他说在吴健雄在1949年就做了第一个这个实验。
Well, I mean, it's a discovery. I mean, it's the first discovery of gravitational waves on Earth. So it's a discovery, and I cannot say it more, that all discoveries could, in principle, be given a prize. Then you have to judge yourself if it's of scientific height enough.
Well, it's the Nobel Physics Prize in contradictory to the Max Planck Prize for physics. I mean, if one wins the Max Planck Physics Prize, can he still win the Nobel Prize for physics?
Oh, yes. I mean, you can win any other prize, you know, and still get the Nobel Prize. So there's no... as long as your discovery or invention fulfills the criteria, then of course you're eligible to win the prize. That's for sure. There are many prizes around the world these days, so some people collect prizes.
Have you 问题吗？那假如没有问题的话。我们再谢谢这个，let us thank Professor Brinker.